This talk will show you how to acquire and how you read prostate images according to PI-RADS. These are my disclosures. So let's start with an introduction. The content of my talk can be read in European Urology Surgery in Motion, Part 1, 2, and 3. So let's first start to discuss the value of prostate MR imaging. According to four level of 1A papers, MRI shows you where to direct the needle. These are the four papers: Lancet, New England Journal, European Urology, and Cochrane Systematic Review. Let's start with the Cochrane Systematic Review. 20 studies, more than 5,000 papers. First message is that in 1/3 of the patients, you can safely avoid biopsy. The detection rate of significant cancer is 96%. Second, the detection rate of insignificant cancer is going down with 11% from 28 to 17. Is a non-inferiority of the MRI technique concerning the detection of significant cancer. It even goes up 2%. If you have an expert MRI, the 4M study shows that you can safely avoid biopsy in almost half of the patients. The overdetection rate goes down with 11%. And again, also here you have a slight improve of the detection of significant cancer. If you look at PI-RADS 3 to 4, you can see that the detection of significant cancer goes up with 11%. These papers have resulted in the change of the EAU prostate cancer guidelines. Guidelines now advise to perform prostate MRI before any biopsy. So with this, we have a tsunami of prostate MRs coming. Now let's see what actually is multiparametric MRI. And even more important, what does it show? Well, multiparametric MRI is the integration of three techniques. They help each other. It shows anatomy, T2. It shows biology with diffusion, and it shows vascularity by dynamic contrast enhanced MRI. Let's start with anatomy, T2 weighted images. These images show the anatomy as if it was a drawing. You can see on the T2 weighted image the peripheral zone being white with linear strands of connective tissue, and in the center you see the transition zone. Usually there is here a lot of benign prostatic hyperplasia. A lesion usually has a lower signal intensity. But this cannot only be cancer, but also it can be hematoma, prostatitis, or benign prostatic hyperplasia. So you need other images to further make this differentiation possible. And for this we use diffusion-weighted imaging. With diffusion-weighted imaging, we are looking at the speed of the water molecules in between the cells. When there is a lot of space, as is in normal prostate tissue or low-grade cancer, the speed is high, and on the so-called apparent diffusion coefficient map, this is bright. However, if you have a Gleason 5 component tumor, there is no space, so the cells are tightly packed, and this is on the image black, low velocity. So when you see a black hole on the so-called apparent diffusion coefficient map, it is likely to be an aggressive cancer. The last component of multiparametric MRI is vascularity, dynamic contrast MRI. After contrast injection, hypervascular tissue shows enhancement, like cancer, but also other structures like BPH and prostatitis show enhancement. This is the lesion, this is cancer, and centrally you see the enhancement of a hypervascular cellular BPH nodule. Now, the imaging of prostate cancer starts with acquisition. You need to have a good image. Thereafter, you need to do a good interpretation. And finally, you need to hit the target with MR-directed biopsy. These three components are the basic components for the quality of prostate MRI. So let's start with acquisition. If you follow the guidelines, this not always guarantees the acquisition of a nice image. So it is not a push button. It is more difficult. Both images are acquired according to the guidelines. And you see a low quality on the left and a good quality on the right. Here the diagnosis was made 3 times a significant cancer. So this is a patient eligible for biopsy. Whereas with a good quality image, you nicely can see that this is a Pi-RADS 1. Nicely marginated nodules. So this is normal. No biopsy. Based on Adelphi analysis, experts in Europe advise to check the quality of a prostate MR image and to mention it in the report. I now would like to show you a few examples. Is the image quality of this patient good? Well, the hips are nice with a high resolution. However, the prostate itself is blurred. This is motion artifact. And when you repeat the image with a faster sequence, you can see that you have a better quality. This shows you the motion of the prostate. And you can see that the prostate is a quite movable organ. This is the urinary bladder, and this is the rectum. And based on air in the rectum, the prostate moves a lot. The rectal gas also causes distortion of the diffusion weighted image. This is a T2 axial image. You can see here air in the rectum. This is the urinary bladder. And you can see that the air in the rectum on the B1400 diffusion weighted image causes distortion at the red arrows. And the prostate itself doesn't show the true anatomy anymore. This is the sagittal image showing the urinary bladder, prostate over here, and here rectal gas. Now, how can we improve this? Well, we can improve this by removing the rectal gas, for example, with a urinary catheter. The same patient with a urinary catheter over here, you can see it, it's a lower signal intensity, no rectal gas, and you can see that the prostate B1400 image shows an identical anatomy as to the T2. This is before and this is after removal of rectal gas. A big improvement. Now, what about the field strength? 3 Tesla is preferred. However, in patients with, for example, a pacemaker or a hip prosthesis, you can consider a 1.5 Tesla. But gradients are more important. Steep gradients are linearly related to the quality of the image. So a 1.5 Tesla machine with steep gradients is better than a 3T without. This is a T2 weighted image. And my question is, which one is the 3 Tesla and which one is the 1.5? Well, you really cannot tell. This actually is the 1.5 and this is the 3 Tesla. You see a lesion over here. Now, what about coils? You don't need the endorectal coil anymore with the modern MR systems. So no endorectal coil. Contrast. To DCE or not to DCE, that is the question. So should we use dynamic enhancement? There's a nice paper of Marloes van der Leest et al. Of the 4M study that clearly shows that you can increase the number of MRIs from 2 to 3 when you omit the use of contrast. Furthermore, if you look at the quality of multiparametric versus biparametric MRI, you can see that the quality is equal. So, No contrast means no allergy and no gadolinium brain deposition. This is the prostagram of the future, an MRI without contrast combining T2 in black and white and diffusion in orange. And you can see clearly that there is a big lesion on the dorsal side in the prostate in the peripheral zone, based on diffusion and T2, no contrast. However, the use of contrast requires expertise. This graph shows you that the number of PIRATS 3s, that means the equivocal diagnosis, is increasing when you omit the use of contrast. The expert goes up from 6% to 8%. So that is not much. However, I'm much more concerned about the less experienced radiologist. His level of equivocal diagnosis can go up from 25% to 33%, and that is quite a lot. So, DCE helps to find the tumor. DCE is reducing uncertainty. And DCE is especially helpful in less experienced radiologists. Therefore, the PIRATS committee advises that we still need to have both an enhanced and contrast enhanced MRI. We only can say based on future studies that in some patients we can obviate the use of contrast. Now let's talk about interpretation reading. This is part 2. And now I'm going to discuss PIRATS version 2.1. We need to speak one language, otherwise the Chinese, the Italian and the Russian cannot understand each other. And the common language we are using is English. In prostate it is PIRATS. PIRATS version 1 was published in 2012, so about 10 years ago. Since then there have been multiple upgrades. Now we have version 2.1, which was published in European Urology in 2016. PIRATS is an assessment category in a Likert 5-point scale, showing the likelihood of the presence of a significant cancer from highly unlikely to highly likely. Now, what is a clinical significant cancer on MRI? It is a Gleason grade of 2 or higher, which includes a 3+4 component with a prominent but not a predominant 4 component. And or a volume that exceeds 0.5 cc and or extra prostatic extension. Now in PIRATS version 2.1 we have a different weighting from the peripheral and the transition zone. In the peripheral zone, diffusion weighted imaging is the dominant sequence, whereas in the transition zone T2 is dominant. You can remember transition zone T2. And DCE plays a minor role. Now, PIRATS version 2.1 tries to make the interpretation KISS. Keep it simple and stupid. It is a simple algorithm and table that determines the overall score, the assessment category. And these are the tables. The T2 for the peripheral and transition zone, for diffusion. And in a few minutes I'm going to show you the images and the tables. Now this is PIRATS version 2.1 for the transition zone with T2. Let's start. This is a normal peripheral zone, bright, PIRATS 1, with normal strands of tissue. Now here you see an ill-defined mild hypo-intense lesion, usually indistinct. This is a 2 and probably a prostatitis. And post-prostatitis you see a triangular linear structure which is a PIRATS 2 also and which is fibrotic tissue after prostatitis. Now, when you have a focal lesion, it is a 4. When the focal lesion is large, when it exceeds 1.5 centimeter, it is a 5. When it shows extraprosthetic extension, as for example here, obliteration of the rectoprosthetic fat and the rectoprosthetic angle, then this is a clear Pirates 5 on T2. Obliteration of the rectoprosthetic angle. Now, the T2 weighted sequence is most important for the transition zone. So let's look at T2 for transition zone. So this is the new 2.1 version. When you have a fully encapsulated lesion, which can be heterogeneous, then you have a 1. This is a normal BPH nodule. When it's partly encapsulated, it's a 2. When it's non-encapsulated, it's either a 3 or a 4. When you see a lesion like this, non-encapsulated, which is different from the so-called organized chaos of normal BPH, then this is a tumor, a significant cancer. And how can you recognize it? Well, this is in magnification, organized chaos, whereas here you see erased charcoal. Homogeneous intermediate signal intensity. Erased charcoal versus organized chaos. Now there is disruption of the organized chaos by this mass space occupying lesion. And because this lesion exceeds 1.5 centimeter, it's not a Pirates 4 on transition zone, T2, but a 5. Look at this patient. This is a lesion in the peripheral zone. But if you look at the organized chaos here of the transition zone, then you can see that something is going on here anteriorly. This is a disruption of the organized chaos by a homogeneous erased charcoal lesion. It usually has a typical lenticular shape. And because this is larger again than 1.5 centimeters, it is a Pirates 5. Now let's discuss the role of diffusion weighted imaging. This is most important for the peripheral zone. However, it doesn't matter from the table whether you have transition or peripheral zone. So I will discuss now only the peripheral zone with the dominant sequence, diffusion weighted imaging. Now let's start with a Pirates 1. On the ADC map, the apparent diffusion coefficient map, the peripheral zone normally is white and the lesion is a focal black structure. On the B1400, normal peripheral zone is black, with a lesion being bright. Now you see a lesion over here, black on ADC, focal, and bright on diffusion. So you would call this an abnormal lesion, a Pirates 4. However, you should remember that in the upper third of the prostate, in the median line, you have the muscular sleeve of the ejaculatory ducts which are merging. So this is a pitfall. Usually you can see this. Don't call this a lesion. It is in the midline, it's symmetric, does not enhance, and it's the upper part of the prostate, cranial to the veromontanum. When there is a non-focal hypointensive lesion on ADC, like the one over here, and a bright lesion non-focal on B1400, you may call it a 2. When one of the lesions is focal, like the one over here, and the other is not, so focal black on ADC, but not on the B1400, it is a 3. It can also be the reverse. Focal on B1400, bright, and non-focal on ADC. When you have a focal lesion on the ADC map, black, and bright on the B1400, it is a 4. When it's larger than 1.5 centimeter, it's a 5. So this was diffusion weighted imaging. Now let's shortly discuss DCE, dynamic contrast enhancement. With DCE, it's either plus or minus. It is plus when there is focal and earlier enhancement compared to the rest of the prostate tissue, and when this area matches a suspicious finding on the other sequences. Let's see how it looks like. This is pre-contrast, post-contrast, ADC. A suspicious black focal lesion on ADC, which matches enhancement. So, this is a plus. Here is another black lesion, and enhancement clearly matches this lesion. Also a plus. When there is no early enhancement, or it does not correspond to the other lesion, it is a minus. Also, the new version of 2.1 takes into account of the anatomy of enhancement. So if you have the so-called popcorn enhancement, which is typical of BPH, and this can enhance early, you should not call this positive because it is BPH. And BPH typically can enhance early. Now when you see, however, a confluent enhancing lesion within the area of normal popcorn BPH enhancement, it is a suspicious lesion and you should call this a plus. So now how are we going to work with PI-RADS? How are we going to integrate the three sequences? And this is what you're going to do today. Well, it's fairly simple. Look at where the lesion is located. If it's in the periphery, diffusion is the most important sequence. So PI-RADS is following diffusion. 1, 1, 2, 2, etc. However, when you have a 3, you can have an upgrade to PI-RADS 4 when there is early enhancement, so a plus on DCE. Now the transition zone follows the T2. However, a score of 2 with the transition zone can be upgraded based on a diffusion of 4 and higher. A score of 3 can be upgraded to a 4 by a diffusion of 5. Now, this is what you are going to do in your workshop. Score the lesions. Now, one thing is important. Tell your radiologist that you will perform a DRE on him when he is not good. And DRE means develop radiological expertise. With this, I thank you very much for your attention. And later on, we will have some questions and answers. Thank you again.